The next big set of thing I want to talk about from the Dune trailer are costume details. Not one big thing, a lot of small things that we've been picking this apart to an extent since we got the first promo images. And for the most part, even with this trailer, what we've seen are the Atreides. We haven't seen that much of the Harkonnens and none of the Imperial Court under House Carino. And I understand, you know, it's a plot point that the Atreides are modest nobility, that they don't stand on ceremony, that they dress functionally, that they're soldiers, even in their uniforms, they're not meant to intimidate, they're just there. They're serving a purpose. They're supposed to look relatively normal. Even Duke Leto and Paul's clothes when they're on Caladan, they just look like well-cut but modest clothes of a power magnate or something. It doesn't look like something out of a Renaissance painting. And I understand that they're trying to do that, but we're not seeing, like, I keep thinking of the Star Wars prequel trilogy, where when you see senators in the Galactic Senate, that they're dressed really ostentatiously to show I represent an entire planet and I am a powerful person. And I didn't think that was too weird in that. It was interesting. Or looking at a Coruscant nightclub of all the interesting designs, showing this is what the well-to-do wealthy people and aristocrats dress like, versus, you know, just someone working in overalls. Now, this is a point where I have had strong disagreements with Quinn Howard of Quinn's Ideas of Ice and Fire and his Dune channel, that he has repeatedly mocked the costumes from the Sci-Fi Channel Dune miniseries, that he believes that they were too ostentatious and downright silly, and man, that was the point. How can you be knocking the costumes, man? That was the point. You can't just have, you know, all the, well, it's a functional, you know, still suit and something. We have to have pomp. There has to be pomp. Damn it. You can't just take away the pomp and the circumstance. It's a plot point, damn it, that they're this decadent aristocracy ruling over a galactic society filled with their internal feuds that has become stagnant as a result of that. The whole point is they look like out-of-touch aristocrats from feuding Italian city-states in the Renaissance, setting themselves up above everyone else in, like, a class system. That's, you need to show how ostentatious it has become. Like, I'm just thinking of this now, the Hunger Games movies. They have the capital civilians dress really weird and really expensive and really wacky with all this makeup, just to draw the contrast between them and these dirt-poor coal miners they're oppressing. That you're conveying, like, when she comes to do the culling, their representative, and it's just, you wear more than I can make in a year, with all this makeup and stuff that is not functional. That you need to show that with the royal court. I mean, like, the phrase, born to the purple, is because purple color dye was very expensive, so of course the emperors wore it all the time in Rome. This ties into the issue of when will we actually see the Imperial Court, that if we're mostly just seeing the Atreides army and Harkonnen soldiers, or the Fremen with their still suits, which are, you know, functional, we're not seeing a lot of ceremonial costume. Like, they must have this at some point, like in the Water of Life scene at the very end, before the time skip. Or it's a religious ceremony with the Fremen, you think they'd be dressed differently, like they take off their still suits when they're in the siege. So I don't know how they're going to play that. But we've only seen, like, people in overalls and flight suits, as it were, functional things, but not more elaborate costuming. We haven't even seen what the Baron dresses like. So, I mean, the miniseries, you saw the Emperor fairly consistently since part one. They worked him in well. And in the process, you'd see just how decadent and well-dressed and ostentatious the Imperial Court looks. And those are really, and it was hit or miss, but, like, were all of Princess Amidala's costumes good? No, but the ones that were are iconic, and people still wear them to Halloween. So I really hope we get better costuming details in principle when we see members of the aristocracy, which we haven't so far because we're looking at soldiers, which is fine. Now, one thing I've noticed in terms of the visual look of everyone, which people have remarked on, is we noticed from these trailers, this is the first time we're seeing Harkonnens, and they're all bald. I mean, not just bald, but they're hairless. They don't have eyebrows or anything. And not just the Harkonnen family, like Raban. I mean, all of their soldiers are bald. And Quinn was theorizing on this, that they're trying to show it's a phenotype that developed, you know, from a population bottleneck. It has been 20,000 years, you know, populations get isolated. I think they're showing Harkonnens and their soldiers as hairless and pale. This is me speculating, to show how polluted their homeworld is. Gaidi Prime, that they say that it's just this industrial wasteland where they aren't concerned about using it up because, hey, we can always have the Emperor give us another planet to rule. So it's just, there's oil everywhere in the dirt, in the air, and it's relatively toxic just from over-industrialization. So maybe that's the baldness is their way of showing that, whereas Caladan is filled with water and life and this beautiful Arcadia of, it looks like the Acropolis in Greece, that you'll see all these factories and stuff and soot and pollution from the Harkonnen homeworld. And maybe that's why they're hairless like that. I'll have to hear what their reasoning for this was. And just, I only picked this up the second time I watched the trailer because it was really fast. But just, you know, I smiled when I saw it. Like, this is the third thing that might make me, it wasn't quite a wow moment, but it was just, I grinned ear to ear. That when they show Raban, played by Batista, really fast, it starts by the camera focusing on his hip, then going to his face. And when it's on his hip, he has an ink vine whip, like in the books. And just, it took you a minute to pick up on it, just wow. If you're not familiar with this, Inkvine is, it's a whip coated in neurotoxin, basically. And Gurney Halleck escaped from slavery under the Harkonnens to become this military commander under the Atreides. And Raban killed his whole family and personally whipped him at one point. So he's got this long scar on his face from the Inkvine that Raban slashed him with this whip, and it's this really potent neurotoxin, so it's unthinkably painful. And that they kept that in. Like, the miniseries did a great job with the Baron Harkonnen, but really didn't do much with his nephews. Which, granted, the books didn't do much with Raban either, but Fade, they tried to work it in the miniseries, and he was decent. They cut a lot out from the books. He was okay. He was just kind of there. He didn't impress you the way Ian McNeice did. That I don't think the miniseries ever really portrayed that Fade is like this anti-Paul. He's the opposite of Paul Atreides. And just as physically capable. And we'll see how that goes. But for the moment, they're building up the Beast Raban, which is great, which is great. It's from the books. They're actually getting this across, that the Harkonnens want him to brutalize Arrakis, so when they send in his younger brother, he'll be hailed as a liberator. And is a man who killed his own father, who has brutalized Arrakis for years, and everyone who's talked about Batista in this says he is just menacing as Raban. It is not a joke character. He's a brute, but he's a brute to be feared, not one to laugh at, which the miniseries really didn't do much with. And I realize he was supposed to be a pushover, but I didn't think I'd look forward to Raban in this as much as I do now, having seen Batista in this, and just the Inkvine whip. That was great. One other point here, while I'm talking about uniforms and military stuff, is we're pretty sure these are Sardaukar, the Emperor's elite shock troops. But I do want to point out that if this is them attacking the Atreides on Arrakis, it's a plot point that the Baron gave them Harkonnen uniforms and outfits so they could maintain the token lip service that it was really the Harkonnens who attacked the Atreides, not the Emperor's elite shock troops. And it's a political fiction. Everyone knows the Emperor had a hand in this, but to overtly attack the Atreides would have been an overreach of his power. So, I think these are supposed to be Harkonnen stillsuits, Harkonnen designs, but with Sardaukar in them. We'll have to see how they play that. The whole point is it's not a false flag. That's when you're trying to shift blame onto someone, but they're hiding by wearing Harkonnen uniforms so people don't know the Harkonnens have Sardaukar help. Though I will point out that I noticed this pausing it endlessly. The Harkonnens are bald and don't even have eyebrows on their infantry. When we see a shot of this guy's face in his helmet, he has eyebrows and this sort of tattoo over his right eye, which I think their take on the Sardaukar is that they have their rank insignia and information tattooed on their face for ease of reference. What's the best way to see someone's rank on the battlefield or medical info? Have it tattooed on them. Has anyone in the comments here ever seen that Kurt Russell movie from 1998 called Soldier? Tying it all back together, you know, Villeneuve did Blade Runner 2049. Kurt Russell's Soldier movie was written by one of the co-writers of the original Blade Runner, and he considers it a side quill. Hey, I was one of the co-authors on the screenplay for that. I feel like it's set in the same universe, even though it's out on a different planet. And tonally, you get some of the sense of that. That Kurt Russell plays this soldier who has been trained from birth to just be a killing machine, and all of the soldiers in his unit have their names, rank, and medical info and tech specs tattooed on their cheek, so for ease of reference. So I wonder if it reminds me of that. Are they doing that with the Sardaukar as a costuming detail, that they have their rank info tattooed on their forehead, on one side of their head, like a barcode? That would be so cool, just to show these are guys who are bred for war. That's all they do. They are soldier fanatics, the Sardaukar, to defend the Golden Lion Throne. I should probably tell you all sooner instead of later that in terms of Atreides, Carino, or Harkonnen, I am a Carino fan. And maybe that's because I'm a Targaryen fan, and the whole Imperial House trying to get back what it's lost, and just the romanticism of the Carinos and the elite Sardaukar. Just, it's always awesome to me. More so than, how could you like the Harkonnens? They're so evil and sadistic and dirty. Just, there's oil everywhere. It's unpleasant. It would be unpleasant to live on Gaidi Prime compared to, like, the pomp and hooray we're on Khitane and Seleucia and dealing with the Imperial Court. I'm fascinated by the Carinos and the prequel books about the Carinos and dealing with the court life and stuff. So I thought it was an interesting thing. I was pausing this and going, these are Sardaukar because the Harkonnens don't have eyebrows. And that's how they're playing it. But they might be wearing Harkonnen uniforms. But everything up to now I've been saying, I point out, we're mostly seeing people in military uniforms. And we're not really seeing much of well-to-do civilians like aristocrats who can dress well. The one exception to which is Lady Jessica, which even she's not too ostentatious because the Atreides aren't in general, but we get these shots of her in her costume. We had some still shots in the behind-the-scenes Q&A thing they did leading up to it. I'm posting this here. We have one or two new shots of what her whole costume looks like, which she has this really long train behind her dress. Looks very nice. I can't wait to see the whole thing. The biggest part was just, yeah, they'll have Lady Jessica and her handmaids and well-to-do women in this. They wear all-encompassing veils over their heads. It looks like something out of Kingdom of Heaven, that they have to wear veils with all these decorative chains and stuff, because there's sand blowing everywhere. It's a desert environment. That's like the one thing we saw in this that wasn't purely functional, but really decorative. And I wonder, like, by extrapolation, if this is what the relatively functional Atreides are wearing, what the heck does the Imperial Court look like in terms of the ostentatiousness and the pomp? So far we're seeing, you know, people are losing their mind at how cool the stillsuits look because they look functional. And I get that. But it's not amazing stuff that would inspire people to draw fan art compared to, like, stuff Irulan was wearing in the 2000 miniseries. Really like the costumes in that.